None of us are getting any younger, but here's a scary thought. Today is the youngest we'll ever be. And with the wisdom of old age comes the realization that maybe we should have put away a little bit more for our golden years. Well, one man who's been looking at it is John Piggott. He's a director of the ARC Centre of Excellence in Population Ageing Research, or CEPAR. John, it's great to have you with us today.
Thank you very much, Julian.
So I've seen various figures for how much we should be putting away for old age. 1 million, 2 million or others have just suggested just as much as you can afford. What should we really be looking at?
Well, it depends how well you want to live in retirement. That's one thing. It also depends how long you're prepared to work before you start relying on your retirement accumulations. If your salary is not that high, you will be able to draw on the age pension. In fact, 3/4 of the retired population currently draw on the age pension, at least in part. Half draw the full age pension. So that gives lower income individuals a lot of income security. That age pension in Australia is wage indexed to community standards. And so it's a very important form of longevity insurance for your old age. It goes on until you die. It's there for both you and your partner. So it's got many strengths. If you are in perhaps the upper half of the income range and you want to maintain that standard of living, you need a remarkably large amount of capital. In many countries, this is expressed in terms of what you would be able to draw down in terms of income for the rest of your life. But in Australia, we express it in terms of the wealth. And so the wealth seems very large, but actually people are going to live a long time and they're going to need a lot of wealth to maintain a commensurate standard of living through their retirement, if they've been earning well through their lifetime.
But at the same point, when they've been earning well, they've had huge expenses. Think of the mortgage, raising children, all these extra expenses. Now, should people actually be thinking that they should only retire once those are paid off, and therefore they just need the money to live?
Well, patterns are changing. So, for example, there's family breakdown, which now occurs much later than was once the case. So people are now approaching the retirement window with debt that they once would not have had. And some of their superannuation accumulations is often used to retire that debt so that they're at least secure in their own home and they have what's left then to supplement their age pension payout or whatever it might be.
But people, again, don't seem to realise just how long they may live. It used to be 70 years and 10 and, and that was it. And now that's almost treated as your working age.
People almost always underestimate how long they might expect to live. Someone aged 65 in Australia, a male aged 65, could expect to live past 90.
And that's with current age spans, which are, of course, increasing as medical care gets better.
And so I think, generally speaking, people need to be conservative in terms of how much they might need to get them through retirement.
And particularly for those people who suddenly get to retirement age, they have a great celebration in the office at, say, 65. They're presented with a huge pot of money, they think, from their superannuation fund. What should they actually be doing with it?
Well, that's a good question. I think people like to have some control over the capital that they receive, and I think that's reasonable. There are all sorts of uninsurable events that occur later in life. They could be medical, or they could be something to do with their children, and they want to have a discretionary pool of capital to draw on. One possible way forward to combine that discretion with some longevity insurance is to insure late in life. So there are instruments which are beginning to happen in Australia now. Retirement products, when I say instruments, I mean retirement products that are beginning to happen late in life, beginning to happen in Australia, beginning to be available in Australia now. And I think there are policy initiatives afoot that will make them more accessible and more affordable. And these are called deferred annuities. So you can hang on to most of your capital, but for a relatively small sum of money, you can buy an income stream which starts, let's say at 85, or at 87, supposing you live that long. Now, one reason it's a small sum of money is that some people die, and that becomes part of the pool for the payout. Another reason is you're putting this money in at, say, 65, and it accumulates between when you're 65 and when you're 87. So for maybe 15% of your superannuation capital, you can buy something which gives you a respectable standard of living late in life. And that means that you can plan what's left, right? So when people say, well, what are you going to do with your retirement income? First question is, well, how long am I going to live? But if you buy one of these things, then you say, well, actually, I only have to plan for 20 years or 22 years or whatever the gap might be. And then that becomes a well-posed question that you're able to answer. So I think those kinds of instruments are a good halfway house between giving people some discretion over their retirement resources and some insurance when they really need it, which is, am I going to live that long or not? Right? That's the uncertainty. That's the thing, the risk you need to insure against.
Well, other countries have had annuities for many, many years, and they seem to be much more popular, particularly in Europe, than they are in Australia. Many people in Australia have never even heard of an annuity.
Well, that's true. I think the UK in particular had a very strong annuity market, was supported by very strong tax incentives and compulsion for some period. That has now been removed. It will be interesting to see what happens to retirement incomes in the annuity market in the UK with that withdrawal, whether new retirees end up buying annuities or buying some other kind of retirement income product like what we have, like account-based pensions, which is what a lot of people use in Australia.
But equally, if people haven't got an annuity, some people may think about working and carrying on in the workforce. Now, this would have huge advantages, particularly for those people who say, just get a bit bored in retirement. But is it good for the country that we end up with a somewhat older population working?
Oh, yeah. I think policies everywhere are being devised to encourage mature labour force participation, to find ways of encouraging firms to keep workers on later. There is an argument which says, oh, well, these people are squeezing out the young. But this is fallacious. The way to think about an economy is like a balloon, which goes up and down with the amount of economic activity. And so in some sense, labour supply at mature ages creates its own demand. Now, if you're used to operating in an office which has 30 employees, you're thinking about a crate, right? You have to remove someone before somebody else comes in. That's not true of the economy as a whole. It's called the fallacy, lump of labour fallacy. It's got a name, right? And it's been around for 100 years, that fallacy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So there's nothing but upside to mature labour force participation. It's a matter of finding appropriate incentives and appropriate workplace conditions so that workers can manage continued employment into later age, at which point many people have other responsibilities. They have responsibilities for frail elders, or they have responsibility for grandchildren and so forth. So it's not a matter so much of taking leisure when you retire. It's a matter of, well, family becomes more important. So workplaces have to devise mechanisms for accommodating that. In much the same way as a generation or two ago, they had to devise mechanisms for coping with women with young children coming back into the workforce. They had special conditions. Right?
It's one of the issues that I know the intergenerational report looks at. Well, it's twice a decade, isn't it? It gets a lot of attention at the time, and yet it seems we then almost forget about it for another four and a half years.
It's true of a lot of government documents. The European Commission does it for a large number of countries. There are not that many countries outside that community that produce intergenerational reports. So at least we have something. Mm-hmm. And while it has many shortcomings, it provides some kind of a benchmark against which other work can mm-hmm. be measured. I think it's a useful exercise to undertake.
But one thing that did certainly look at policy was a Henry review. I know you're also on the panel of it. So briefly and finally, I know it looked at, the budget in Australia, both state and also nationwide, seems to be implying that we are heading for a larger structural deficit, which would, of course, make a 40 and older population more difficult. Is that really the case?
Oh, yeah. I think a lot of it is driven by the ageing demographic. There's no question that the per capita government expenditures will be going up. Mm-hmm. And those outlays will have to be financed, and they're going to have to sooner or later be financed by taxes. Mm-hmm. We can run deficits for a little while. Our national debt is not a disaster by any means yet, but there's only one direction without tax reform. Mm-hmm. Right? So what should those tax reforms be? Well, that's something that I think the tax white paper will address. Right? But on the table is an increase in consumption taxation, increase in the rate of GST, is maybe increasing the progressivity of the personal income tax. People have talked about the top rate of the personal income tax going to 51% from its current 49. Now it was 47, and then there was a levy, a deficit emergency levy, I think they called it, which pushed it up a bit. Mm-hmm. It could go up further. Personally, I would not be opposed to that, but I think that's a matter for community debate and for community consensus.
Definitely. In all of this, however, we're missing the one bit of good news, which is we are actually living longer. Yeah. It's a
victory for humankind in many ways, and it's all happened in the last two centuries. We're living a very lucky time.
We certainly are. John Piggott, it's been great talking to you.
Thank you so much.